الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك على سيدنا محمدٍ وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. You know, the question that has been perplexing to philosophers, scientists and theologians is really the origin of man. Where is, you know, how mankind was existed on earth? And there came two schools emerged in this regard. One school, which is the creationist, which they say that believe that man was created as he is now in the form that we have by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the father of all mankind is Sayyidina Adam, Prophet Adam. However, this school considered that through the ages, there could be, because of environmental condition, could be changed, minor physical change to man. So for example, the color could change. You know, our color, for example, the people in China, people in the United States, in Europe, and you know, in Africa, might be different than the color of Prophet Adam. And there is also some changes that could happen because of the genetic makeup of the parents. So these are minor changes, but the fundamental creation of man in the shape that we are in now was created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second school, which is the evolutionist school, and they said that man was created through an evolutionary process. And this school actually have two sub-schools on them. One of them said that this evolutionary process was a random process. And the second one, they say that this evolutionary process was an intelligent process. That means there is God. God have was the one controlled that evolution process. You know, while actually we can don't object too much that the evolutionary process might have happened for animal and some birds, although there are certain animals have not been, there is no evolution for them. They were created from day one. But this theory or this concept of the evolutionary process cannot be proven by any, you know, level of certainty. And the reason actually for this lack of certainty, because the creation of man cannot be derived from the celestial knowledge that can only be obtained by the divine revelation. So you cannot actually by any certainty establish how man was created except through a revelation, because it is some of the unseen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us this في سورة الكهف, when he said ما أشهدتهم خلق السماوات والأرض ولا خلق أنفسهم وما كنت متخذ المضلين عضدا. I did not have them witness the creation of the heavens and earth, nor their own creation. So nobody witnessed this creation. And I would never take misleaders for helper. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, basically, you cannot figure out the creation of the heavens and earth or man except actually by the revelation in this regard. So in this talk, what I will try, inshallah, and in the end, you will be judged if I succeeded or did not, to explain, you know, the verses in the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened for us the door of heaven, so to reveal for us our creation, how we were created. And the story actually of creation of man is the first story in the Quran. You know, if you look at the Quran, it has many stories, but the first story is the story of the creation of man. And this is revealed in Surah Al-Baqarah in verses 30 to 33. Now, the creation of man have mentioned in many other, you know, surahs after this, but that's why, because it is a subject of interest to man, and it's important to us. We want to know where we came from. Every human being wants to know where he came from, where he is going, you know, what is his role on earth, and so on. All of these questions are fundamental questions for anybody who wants to think. You know, so we'll look at what is this, the verses that, you know, was recited in the beginning are these verses from, as I said, from 30 to 33. And it started, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. So when you have listened to it, when the Lord have told the angel, I am placing a Khalifa, or I'm making a Khalifa on earth. So they said, will you place in it somebody who will cause mischief and shed blood, while we him your praise and glorify your holiness? And Allah said, I know that which you do not know. So somehow the first encounter happened, Allah told he's going to put a Khalifa. The angel, you know, expressed the concern about this entity that's going to go in. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verses continue, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ قَالَ أَنْبِئُونِي بِأَسْمَاءِ هَؤُلَاءِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا أَنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Adam all the names. And then he placed them before the angel and said to them, tell me their names if you are so truthful. If you know everything, tell me the names. They said, glory to you, we have no knowledge except what you have taught us. You are the all-knowing and the all-wise. قال يا آدم, then Allah subhanahu said, قال يا آدم أنبيهم بأسمائهم فلما أنبأهم بأسمائهم قال ألم أقل لكم إني أعلم غيب السماوات والأرض وأعلم ما تبدون وما كنتم تكتمون. So Allah subhanahu said, oh Adam, tell them the names, tell them their names. And when he told them their name, Allah said to the angel, didn't I tell you that I know what is unseen in the heavens and in the earth, and I know what you reveal and what you have concealed. So in analyzing these verses, we can actually ask several questions there. The first question will, how did the angel know that man will cause mischief on earth and shed blood? How did they know this? And this, the speculation in this answer is the one actually that lead to this concept about the evolution for some Muslims' mind. Because they said it must be somebody like man-like existed on earth before and was causing mischief and shedding blood, and therefore the angel just related to that experience of the man-like person, entity. But actually other interpreter of the Quran says, no, actually it wasn't a man-like, but was the jinn. The jinn was inhabiting the earth, and this is, they were causing this problem, and that's how the angel related to them. So, but anyway, that's a question. The answers of why they did it is a speculative answer in this regard. The second question is, when the angel made their statement that this vajiran, this entity, will cause mischief and shed blood, they have hidden some information that they know. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, you know, I know what you revealed. Yes, what you revealed, that he is going to do this, I know it. But I also know what you have concealed. That you have concealed something, you didn't say it. You know it, but they didn't, you know, say it. So what is that thing that, you know, the angel have concealed to it? And the third question is, what are the names that Allah subhanahu have told Adam and the angel didn't know? You know, if you really think about it, the angel objected on something, on that this person or this entity will cause mischief and shed blood. So whatever Allah subhanahu is going to do is going to refute their claims that what you are saying is not true. So what is the relationship between the names and basically, you know, refuting the angel's claim? So it has to be a relationship, otherwise there was no address to their, you know, to the issue that they raised. So let me, you know, link these verses, because I said the relationship, you have to make some verses, connect verses from the Quran, and then let's go to verses from Surah Al-A'raf. Because Surah Al-A'raf, you know, verses, that we start with verse 11. Verse 11 is very, actually explains our creation. Because this verse should tell us, reveal to us, that Allah subhanahu, before Allah subhanahu commanded the angel to prostrate to Adam, keep in mind this, before Allah subhanahu commanded, before even Allah subhanahu told them, Allah created every one of us All of us, including you and I, at that time when Adam was created. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ. Talk about all of us. We have created you. ثُمَّ, and emphasize the word ثُمَّ, because ثُمَّ, that means there is time in between. ثُمَّ صَوَّرْنَاكُمْ. ثُمَّ shaped you in a shape. ثُمَّ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ. Then we told the angel to prostrate to Adam. And they prostrated except Iblis. فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ لَمْ يَكُنْ مِنَا أَسَجِدُ. So in this verse, verse Surah Al-Araf 11, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the creation have been done in three steps. The first step that we, you know, were khalaqan, created us. Then thumma, then after certain time, and thumma means zin, which means there is always a time duration between them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shaped us in the shapes that we are in. And then the third step was, after this, some time passed, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the angel to prostrate to Adam. So we need to look and see what is these different things. So that open also the question is, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angels, He is going to make a Khalifa on earth, at what time that was done? Since we said there is a creation, there is shaping, then there is, you know, prostration, command to prostrate to Adam. So what time was it? And that also tells us that, you know, we have been created first in all of us in heaven in the shapes we are in now. Not there is no evolution for us or Adam or anything. And that time Adam was also created. So we all created at the same time. May said Adam was created, you know, ahead of us. But after our creation, we all died. And only Adam remained. And this is why it comes ثم, then, you know, after this, then Allah ordered the angel to prostrate. So after we died, do we have there something happened in between? But after we died, then Allah subhanahu told the angel prostrate to Adam, because Adam was the only one alive at that existed at that time. So in reality, if you think about it, we have died. You know, if you think we created, then we died. Then we go in the womb of our mother and they get born again and live again, create with another life for us, and then we die again. So our death happened twice. Creation in heaven, shaping in heaven, then death, then creation, or, you know, birth on earth again through the stage of our normal stage of our from our mother's womb, and then we die again, and then we get a life again. So there is two deaths. And these two lives, our life on earth and our life after we in the heaven. The first creation is a different stage, you know, in it. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that you have actually two deaths and two lives. Or we recognize in the hereafter that we have passed through deaths and two lives. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ghafir, قَالُوا, this is in the day of judgment, تُقَارُ رَبَّنَا أَمَتَّنَا سْنَتَيْنِ وَأَحْيَيْتَنَا سْنَتَيْنِ. Our Lord, you have made us die twice and you have brought us to life twice. You know. And then also in Surah Al-Baqarah, كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا. You were dead, and obviously you're dead, that means you existed before. Kuntum, you were dead. How can you disbelieve in Allah when you once were dead? وَكُنْتُمْ فَأَحْيَاكُمْ. Then He gave you life. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ. Then you will die again. ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. So there is obviously here, there is two deaths and two lives. And we said that means that we were created, we died, then we basically born again in life, and then we'll die again, and then we'll have the other life. Now, there is now another in support of this to let us understand. There is several ahadith actually that existed on this regard. Some of them was, you know, it's a very interesting hadith actually, because, but I'll mention one of them and relate to the other. And this hadith, as you see it, I put it in Arabic here, and it's related by Imam Tirmidhi and reported and was narrated by Abu Huraira, that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, when Allah created Adam, He wiped his back, and every soul of his spring that Allah will create until the day of judgment fell from his back. So here is a stage that happened, you know. Then Allah put, then after this we were shaped, and we were all standing. And Allah put in the forehead of every man a flash of light. So we stood now with some recognition of us. So Adam asked Allah, "Oh my Lord, who are they? Well, these that exist." And Allah subhanahu told him, "They are your offspring." Adam saw one of them was charmed with a bright flashlight between his eyes. Out of all of the billions of people that said that Adam saw, that when Allah told him, these are your offspring, your descendants, he saw one with a bright light. And he said, "Oh my Lord, who is this?" And the Prophet ﷺ told him that this is a man from the late nations of yours, your descendants, and his name is Dawood. So Adam said, "My Lord," in this hadith, there is other hadith explained it. Maybe I should say it now. There is actually other hadith says that not everybody has a light on him. There is only a certain number will have light on them, but this entity, Dawood, has the brightest light. And then they said also that in the name of everybody was at her forehead with the age, his age. So Sayyidina Adam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Sayyidina Adam, he asked when he saw the ages, he said, "Well, how long I'm going to live?" And Allah told him in the hadith that he was going to live 1,000 years. He looked, said, "Well, Sayyidina Dawood will only live for, you know, 60 years. Yes. And Sayyidina Adam said, "Okay, can you give him 40 years of mine?" You know, so Adam said, "Well, I have 1,000 years, you know, the wood has 60, give him, and since he is this, have this bright color, bright light, then give him 40 years in it." So anyway, so Allah took a covenant from Adam that this is really what you want. And Adam said, "Yeah, this is what I want." Then when the angel, the hadith continue, it's an interesting in the part of it. When the angel came to Adam and told him, "Now it's the angel of this came and said, we'll take your life." He said, "Wait a minute, my age is 1,000 years. I haven't exhausted 1,000 year yet." And they said, "Well, no, but don't you remember that you have given your son the wood 40 years? So you are going to have to live." So the hadith ends actually with something that describes our characters. And therefore we have to be aware of it. So the hadith ends was Adam forgot that he even given Sayyidina Dawood, you know, 40 years, and all his children forget. So we are by nature are forgetful. We are going to forget. This is, and then Adam denied. He said, "I didn't say it," and all of the children will deny. And Adam made mistake, and all of the children of his children make mistakes. So all of this, you know, it reflects our, you know, our nature, that we are forgetful. We commit something, and sometimes we deny it, and then we also make mistakes. As I said, there are several other hadiths narrated by Tirmidhi and other, which says that Adam was age is 1,000 years, and the names of everybody them. There is also the other hadith by Ibn Abbas, which says that not all of them has the light, but only some has lights. So not every creation has light that shows them. And there is another hadith also by Ubay ibn Ka'b, which he says that, you know, that the people have light, was very bright. And when Adam asked, Allah subhanahu told him, they are the prophets and the messengers. So those people have lights, this bright light was the prophets and the messengers. You know, if you take the different hadiths, you said that at least it's the prophets and the messenger was identified, you know, at that time. Maybe the righteous people was also identified with some form of a light. But you know, the uniqueness was Sayyidina Dawood has more bright light than everybody else. So that is from, you can take this from these, you know, ahadith, and you can said search it. There is probably others on it, but these are the ones that I came up with. Now, while the descendants, now there is another scene that happened, and this is also for Surah Al-A'raf and verses, you know, which 172 to 173. And while the descendants of Adam now were standing, then Allah subhanahu took a covenant from them, a pledge from them. And the pledge is that they worship none but Him. And we know this, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَن تَقُولُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ أَوْ تَقُولُوا إِنَّمَا أَشْرَكَ آبَاؤُنَا مِنْ قَبْلُ وَكُنَّا ذُرِّيَّةً مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ أَفَتُهْلِكُنَا بِمَا فَعَلَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. So Allah subhanahu says for these verses for Surah Al-A'raf, when your Lord brought the offspring from the lines of children of Adam, and the previous description showed that they were standing, all of us were standing at that time, and they made them bear witness about themselves, and Allah by Allah subhanahu asking, am I not your Lord? And we all said, they all said, indeed we bear witness. Then the verse continue, lest you might say on the day of the resurrection, we were not aware of this, we forgot this, you know. Or lest you say, it was our forefathers who were polytheists and we are their late offspring. Will you destroy us by what futile people, futile men have done? So, in interpreting actually this, you know, verse in the Quran, in hadith that narrated by Ubay ibn Ka'b say that at that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually took covenant from everybody. This and make a pledge, they have a pledge from everybody. And then he said in the hadith of Ubay ibn Ka'b, when he said that Prophet would identify, Allah took another special covenant from the Prophets also. Another special covenant for them, for these Prophets and the Messengers. So this scene now of having Sayyidina Adam seeing all his descendants, these billions of people standing in heaven, you know, and repeating and taking, you know, the pledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something of unseen. We have, it is the revelation of the Quran to tell us what it is. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes. This is the, you know, the pledge actually of the hadith of Ibn Ka'b. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come to us in Surah Al-Kahf. And remind us of this also, and tell us, وَعُرُضُوا عَلَىٰ رَبِّكَ صَفًّا لَقَدْ جِئْتُمُونَ كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ بَلْ زَعَمْتُمْ أَلَّن نَجْعَلَ لَكُمْ مَوْعِدًا. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now referred to the Day of Judgment and said, and they will be marshaled before us, before their Lord and Lion, as they were marshaled before, as would happen on the first creation that they have to them. And he said, now you have came back to us as we have created you the first time, yet you thought we wouldn't make an appointed time for you. So that emphasized the point that there was a scene before when we did the pledge, then the next time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remind us, yes, you thought you are not coming to us, but now you came because of the promise, that the commitment of time that we have appointed for you. Now, when we assemble all of these verses, we realize actually that we are not evolved. We actually have been created all together by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time of the creation of Adam. Therefore, none of us is an accident. You know, our parent may not have, you know, planned for us, but Allah subhanahu did before even our parents, you know about it. So long before we were conceived in the womb of the mother, we actually were conceived by Allah subhanahu ta'ala in the shapes that we are now. So now from these verses, you know, it is actually expected that the angel witnessed all of these events. Witness that we stood, witness the lights of the prophets, witness, you know, the pledge that we took, you know, witness all of these things. So at some time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them this, and Adam was the only one available at this time. So we can take this, and I'll make, you know, certain analysis. And now, as I said, at the end of the day, you can agree or disagree with me. That's not. I'm not forcing my opinion on you, but at least to see if I made the sense out of there is logic behind it. One, I said the angels were aware of Adam and his descendants, but did not know their role. You know, when that happened. Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them that He is going to make a vizier unto earth. So they know that there is this creation, and obviously, and you would not ask who are they. You know, that discussion about who are they and so on was between Sayyidina Adam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the angel was seeing this. And the angel expressed the concern that because they saw that there is some of them has darkness over their head and some of them has light, you know, over them. So when they made the claim that the descendant will cause mischief and Allah subhanahu told them, you do not know. And then Allah subhanahu came and taught Adam the names of everybody, everything. And no names will be given until an entity exists. You cannot give a name for something that does not exist, you know. So in the hypothesis I'm making, I am saying that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have named to Sayyidina Adam the names of all of the prophets that have the halos or the light over them. Sayyidina Adam knew only during the first episode, Dawood, because he asked about him. But the rest of them, he didn't know their name. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he came and told them all of the name, and the angel heard of Dawood. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay, tell me the names of those. Because it has to be specific things. He showed them, Allah exposed to them and said, show me, then tell me the names. And at that time, obviously the angel didn't know the name. They also didn't know the name of Dawood at this time. So here, when Allah subhanahu told the angels that, you know, I know what you know, and I know what you have concealed, what the angel concealed that there is prophets and messenger of Allah among them. How can you accuse all of them that they are going to cause mischief and shed blood? You know, there is others among them who are righteous and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than even you. So how come you deny, you are not pointing out this fact? So that is will be the ones, you know. Then it comes in, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hadith actually mentioned the wood specifically? You know, I mean, you think it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Sayyidina Ibrahim, or Sayyidina Muhammad, or somebody, but why Dawood specifically? But it's a very interesting, actually, if you look in the Quran, the whole Quran, you find the word Khalifa, which we said vicegerent, came only twice. Came in Surah Al-Baqarah, referring to Sayyidina Adam, talking about the discussion with Sayyidina Adam, and came in Surah Sad. And in Surah Sad, it referred to Sayyidina Dawood. In Surah Sad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Dawood, Inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard. He is the only one who, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him that in the Quran, said that we made you khalifa in the ard. So Dawood has a uniqueness in this regard. Why Dawood also was unique? Because what did the angel was complaining about? He said, we praise your name and we glorify you. And I revealed about Dawood, that Dawood is the one with all many creation. When he used to do tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many creation was doing it with him. You know, he have a uniqueness. I think the angel, when they do tasbih, they're on their tasbih. But when Sayyidina Dawood was doing tasbih and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all creation around him was doing it, you know. وَسَخَّرْنَا مَعَ فِي سُورَةِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَسَخَّرْنَا مَعَ دَوُودِ الْجِبَالَ يُسَبِّحْنَا وَالطَّيْرِ. And we subjugated the mountains and the birds to do tasbih with Dawood. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, في سورة صاد, He said, وَذْكُرْ عَبْدَنَا دَوُودَ ذَا الْأَيْدِ إِنَّهُ أَوَّابٌ إِنَّا سَخَّرْنَا الْجِبَالَ مَعَهُ يُسَبِّحْنَا بِالْعَشِيِّ وَالْإِشْرَاقِ. والطير محشورة كل له أواب. That in these verses Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that, you know, that actually with Dawood, the mountains was doing tasbih with him, as well as all the birds assembled and doing tasbih with him. So obviously Dawood has a uniqueness that refutes the angels, you know, claim that they are the ones who do the tasbih, you know, than anyone else from people. Now the second part. Now maybe that the last point is let me see this one here. Yeah. The last point, there is a hadith actually, it says that the angel at one point will recognize that man is actually superior in the tasbih than them. There is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when the day of judgment, when the balance will be placed on the day of resurrection, the heavens and earth can be easily put on it. So that balance is huge. To you know, it's a balance that's supposed to measure our actions, our deeds. But they said, you know, the heavens and the whole heavens and the earth, you know, can barely, you know, can fit on it. So that balance is big. And the angel will ask, oh Lord, who's going to weigh? Who are going to weigh by this? This huge balance. And he said, whoever I wish from my creation, you know, لمن شئت من شئت من خلقي. Then الملائكة said, boy, if this one will be weighed by this, we have not, you know, سبحانك ما عبدناك حق عبادتك. Then we have not worshipped you what you deserve, how the way you deserve to be worshipped. If this, whoever you are going to weigh, will weigh his deeds, which will be supposed to be good deeds, with that huge scale, then there is no way our deeds, our tasbih will be, you know, can fit, can basically match this. And then they said, Allah subhanahu put the sirat, وَيُوضَعَ السِّرَاطُ مِسْلَ حَدِّ الْمُنْسِ, that the sirat will be like a razor edge. And the angel said, who is going to be able to permit it to even pass through this? And Allah subhanahu will say, whoever I wish from my creation, they will say, well, oh Allah, we have not worshipped you as you deserve to be worshipped. That means the person who deserves to walk through this laser edge sirat is one must have been, you know, a super worshipper. And obviously, who is going to walk on the sirat? Whose deeds is going to be balanced? Weighted other man that the angel, you know, thought that he is going to be the bad one. And frankly, if you think about it, well, why our worship for Allah subhanahu is even higher than the angel? And when Allah subhanahu put us on higher level than the angel, who are we are obedient? Because the angel have not been subjected, you know, to difficulties, have been subjected to temptation, have been subjected to challenges, but we are. You know, we have our children die young, and we say Alhamdulillah. I mean, isn't that the ultimate expression of this? You know, in fact, I have a relative, you know, who's a nephew of my wife. He's a daughter just graduated from college, and she now, you know, went to, and she works in Egypt. She hasn't been married yet, and she was going to a doctor on crossing the street, and the car hit her. You know, and she basically was in front of the hospital. She was actually going to a hospital, you know, and hit her. And anyway, you know, the end of the day, life ends in a split second. And I just heard this morning that she passed away. I mean, when I call the father, all of what he says, Alhamdulillah. I mean, can you imagine when we pass through this, how much commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala people have when they face such difficulties? Well, the angel never faced this. That's how we reach that point. And this is also the last point. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the angel, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, I know what you do not know, because they don't know all of the future. What is this person is going to do? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't tell them, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَن تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't tell them, I would know what you will never know. You know, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will know. You recognize what that entity that I made Khalifa will do in this regard. So, anyway, so I hope, yeah, that's the hadith. So I hope actually I presented to you a reasonable analysis that consistent, you know, with the revelation in the Quran about our creations. But the, as at the end of the day and every talk I give or anybody gives to you, it's obviously up to you to accept this analysis or accept others or even come with you with your own. I always consider that these things is a matter of curiosities. Frankly, it's not going to change our level because our article of belief is known. This is something that we all curious about. Where are we coming from? Where are we going? And so on. So when we study the Quran and analyze, try Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal to us, you know, a door, open for us a door to understand things that we are curious about. But so the decision at the end to yours, but hopefully at least I made reasonable, you know, analysis in this regard to refute at least the argument of the evolution and support the argument of the creation, but also emphasize the point that we all created in heaven and our role in earth is to prepare ourselves to go back to heaven. So now before I end, I want to point out, and Brother Ahmed is here from, not from Sinat Masjid, but from Hamza Masjid, as I said, and they have a fundraising event in February 22nd. And here is the map, actually. I'm sure most of us went to Hamza, and they have built this facility. And in facility, they have two levels, but they just finishing the first level. They finished all of the part that is shaded in it, and the part that which is light, which I surrounded, you know, with the green, is actually, this is the one they want to have a fundraising for, to basically have a school, have a kitchen when the kids come, a meeting, you know, place, and so on. And this is something, frankly, you know, they wanted, and this is available for all of us too. I mean, we don't have one here, but it's available for us. If we want to use it, we can use it. So in that regard, my belief is that if we're really sincere of supporting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause, we should support it everywhere. But if we only focus in supporting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause by only spending the money on our own masjid that we attend, I really sometimes put doubt in my mind, am I doing it because for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or I'm doing it for my own sake, you know, because I want an ego, I want to brag about my masjid is the best masjid in Houston and so on. So I think we all have to test, frankly, our sincerity when we support some of these projects. I know Imam Qasim is here, and the same thing for him, frankly, because, you know, he has also a community that maybe, you know, may Allah give him all of the wealth, but they're probably not affluent as some of our communities, and therefore we need to support this organization, this masajid. You know, it's not us only. But if you come and say, oh, they ought to raise their own money, well, yes, they ought to raise their own money if they have the resources. You know, but if he is putting himself in a poor community that needs support to do the da'wah, which we will never do and will never go there and do it, then I think it's become obligatory upon us to support him. And I assure you, when you do it, that really will be so sincere because you cannot brag about it. You know, and the same thing with Brother Ahmed and for Hamza, it's not our masjid. If they develop it, they can brag about it, but we at least feel we contribute to it for no reason other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت إنك يا ربنا تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. اللهم اصلح لنا ديننا الذي عصمة أمرنا، واصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا، واصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها مردنا. اللهم اجعل الحياة زادا لنا من كل خير، واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر. اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك، وبطاعتك عن معصيتك، وفضلك عمن سواك. اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك على كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessings, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, purify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge, and make us benefit from what you have taught us. Oh Allah, remedy our sick. Oh Allah, forgive our parent and all the believer, and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, make their graves a garden from heaven. and separate them from their sins as you have separated the east from the west. O Allah, guide our children, protect them and make them righteous. O Allah, accept our repentance, wash our sins, answer our supplication, establish our evidence and guide our heart. O Allah, we ask you, we seek from you all of the good, whether we know it or we don't. And we seek your refuge from all evil, whether we know it or we don't. O Allah, we ask with every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih, warida nafsih, wazinat arshih, wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih, warida nafsih, wazinat arshih, wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih, warida nafsih, wazinat arshih, wa midada kalimatih. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa alladhina amanu wa amalu salihat, wa tawasab bil haqqi, wa tawasab bil sabr, wa akhir da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I forgot to mention Imam Qasim, you know, his father passed away, and I think most of us have knew, you know, about it. May Allah subhanahu grant him the Firdaus al-A'la and give his family patience. And Imam Qasim, you said the Janaza service was January 17th, yeah, so may Allah, and he gave us something which was distributed during his janazah. And you know, I mean, Imam Qasim's father, you know, Shah Ali Khan, he was the one responsible for Imam Qasim becoming a Muslim and his brother becoming a Muslim. So whatever Imam Qasim does, and whoever anybody else who do something becoming Islam on the way of Imam Qasim, his father, alhamdulillah, will be collecting all of these in his day of judgment. And that's why that scale can be filled, you know, with good deeds like this. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.